Thank you very, very much. I am particularly happy to be with you on this occasion, and I have to apologize because I compelled the organization of the Institute to change the date. I was supposed to be here with you last Monday, but something happened in the meanwhile, and so we. And Father Ivan was particularly flexible to me, and he was able to find an alternative. This is not my first time that I'm in Malta. Actually, it's the third or the fourth time I was previously in this church. There is my Father Joe in Guanese here. But any time I have an opportunity to meet with new people and to discover something new. So that increases my happiness. Now, the topic which has been assigned to me, it's a very topical one, in the sense that in these days in particular, people are asking, what is the future of our modern social order, which we identify with neoliberal capitalism? That is the general. In order to answer such a question, let me start from a recent piece of literature, which is the result of an Accenture and the UN Global Compact 2 years ago made a very profound research, empirical research. The study is called CEO Study on Sustainability, and it was published in 2014. Now, they interviewed 1,000 CEO in 27, in 103 countries in 27 industries. And they were asking the following question: how do you perceive the future of our model of social order? And the answer they gave, I quote, is the global economy is on the wrong track and business is not playing its part in forging a sustainable future. Now, what is remarkable is not the sentence itself, but the fact that such a sentence was given by 1,000 top CEO in different countries of the world. And what they, this is the largest study to date in this area. And what I was struck was to read that the CEO said that we need to change market rules. Market rules. In other words, market rules, they write, needed to be shaped to create a level playing field and a race to the top that rewards sustainability preferences. So it is obvious that these people never said we are against market economy, but we need to change the infrastructure of our market economy in order to cope with the problems of our society. Now, having said so, if it is true that there is a general consensus among, social scientists and in particular economists and the public at large on the necessity to modify the situation, we have to acknowledge there is no consensus on the way to push through in order to modify. And that is a critical problem. Is that when you go to a physician, the physician tells you what you have in your body, but he is unable to suggest to you which type of medicine, etc. And we live today in this situation. Everybody is unhappy for one reason or for another. But when we come to meet the question, what should we do, there are. And so now, I want to make sense of this situation. Why is that so? But before doing that, let me synthesize the main challenges that our societies today are facing. One is the growing gap between creative jobs and routine jobs. I am using the wordings of a recent OECD is in Paris, research on it. And the research of OECD is the organization of the advanced countries, okay, of the, in particular Western countries plus Japan and Australia. The researcher have quantified that in the near future, 25% of the labor force will be devoted to creating jobs, which means that the remaining 75 are people who have to accept routine jobs. Routine jobs means, you understand, cleaning or something like that. Now, this poses a problem. Why is it? Because this situation is the one which generates what Pope Francis has recently called surplus people. That is a novelty. Surplus people are not unemployed people. Unemployed always existed in the past, always. But today we have employed, unemployed, and surplus people. It's a new social category. And what are surplus people? People who are considered irrelevant and which can be discarded. In the same way as we discard a piece of bread that we do not want to eat, we put in the dustbin. Here is the same. And that is generating, in general, but in particular for Christians, a problem. Because we know, for Christians, work, labor, is fundamental. Because we have been born in a particular way. And we know ourselves, and we make our identity to flourish by means of work and through work. So if I take away from people, from a human person, work, that is the same as negating his or her own identity. So it's not an economic issue, it's much more than economic. Because if it were an economic issue, one could say, okay, you are discarded, never mind, the welfare state where it says, we are entering the globalization era. Before 83, the word globalization did not exist. What was existent was internationalization, mondialization, but not a world economy, but not globalization. And if you want to be more precise, the Oxford Dictionary of New Words, which is the Bible for the English language, only in the 1991 edition, has a landmark titled globalization. Before, it did not exist. Now, why do I mention this aspect? Not for the benefit of being present, but because globalization is different from internationalization, which always existed. Internationalization means imports and exports. Even in the Old Testament, you know, there are pages talking about import export. Globalization is something different in the sense that it is not only a magnification of international relations, but it's a change of the social and cultural infrastructure of society. And most economists never pay attention to that. They are very superficial. They only consider what is emerging. They calculate how much imports, how many exports, etc., without considering the cultural dimension of globalization, to which I will come in a few minutes, etc. Now, having said so, I have to add another phenomenon which is typical of our day, namely the third and the fourth industrial revolution. Now, as you know, the first industrial revolution occurred in England the second half of the 18th century. The second revolution occurred, the cradle was Germany, at the end of the 19th century. The third and the fourth industrial revolution, the cradle, California, Silicon Valley. Now, the third industrial revolution started in the early 17th until the end of the century. And the fourth industrial revolution is what is occurring today. They started at the beginning of the new century, and today we are in the middle of the fourth industrial revolution. Now, what is important to know is that these two phenomena, globalization and third and fourth industrial revolution, occurred simultaneously. That is a novelty. Because, per se, globalization has nothing to do with the fourth industrial revolution, and vice versa. At the time of the first and second industrial revolution, there was no globalization, as I said before. So we have to be aware that from the marriage, so to speak, of these two phenomena, many causes. One of these causes is what I mentioned before, financialization of the economy. Now, what do we mean by financialization of the economy? We mean the fact that finance today is much, 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 I said this three times, important than the real side of the economy. Real means entrepreneurs who produce commodities and services of one type or the other, etc. Let me give you just a figure. In 1980, the global GDP was more or less the same as the total amount of financial assets. So there was a sort of an equilibrium. Today means 2 years ago, these are official statistics, the total amount, global amount of financial assets, banks and many other institutions, amounts to, be careful, $700 trillion. You know what is a trillion? Trillion is 1,000 billion. It's a figure immense. And this figure is 12 times higher than global GDP. GDP, you know what does it mean, etc. The total. Now that is a phenomenon. Because until the early 80s, there was an equilibrium. Finance was to put to service the real side of the economy, to finance families, to finance enterprises, to do their business. Today is the moment. Finance finances itself. That is what has been called the self-referential nature of financial activity. That is why Pope Francis, and not only him, but many other people stressing the point. Because it is obvious that finance is important. It's fundamental. By the way, you know that finance was created 5,000 years ago. It seems that the first were the Egyptians. Because to finance the construction of the pyramid, they had to invent financial instruments. Very naive, but what today we would call derivatives. Completely different, as you understand. So always finance was put to service the needs of the people in one way or the other. Today, finance is self-reference. And that is the reason of the problem. And being self-reference, it is the longest where greed, you know what does mean greed, avarice, avarice is one of the seven capital vices, and is the second. The first is superbia. What's the superbia? Because the original sin was a sin of superbia. But the avarice is the second. And the avarice is very dangerous from a social point of view. Because if I am a super, I do something wrong to myself. But if I am greedy, I do something wrong also to you. Because that is what people, even sometimes the Christians, do not understand. Because vices, the seven vices, are not on the same level. Are not on the same level. In terms of, let's say, social importance. Because certain vices are individualistic, so to speak. And the same, as I mentioned before. But avarice is the attitude whereby certain groups of people accumulate resources for themselves. Which means they subtract the resources to the other. So the idea of common good disappears. So that is the problem today with financialization. And that today there are no signs of indicating an inversion of tendency. And that is a serious problem. That is why I said before Pope Francis keeps on insisting to create a sort of a transnational agencies to look after this type of activity. A third, let's say, challenge, major challenge, has to do with the phenomenon of the so-called scarcity of commons. You know, in the English language, commons, it's a good which is neither private nor public. So don't confuse commons good with public goods. Okay. What is a common? A common is a good which cannot be attributed to a single entity. A public good is attributed to the government, to the local administration, so you know who is responsible for the maintenance of it. But a common good is a responsibility of the whole community. And in fact, community, common, is a they have the same root, okay? What is the typical example of the common environment? Air, the seas. In other words, a culture is a common good. Culture, in the sense, not so much of cultural goods, statues, monuments, they belong, but culture, in the proper sense of the word, it's a common good. I cannot say culture is mine, or the culture belongs to the government. It only under dictatorship that was said, because under the dictators, you remember, during the time of the Soviet regime, they said culture is our business. But in normal countries, culture belongs to the whole community. So what is the problem? The problem in this regard is that we do not have still a model to ask the following question. How to manage common goods? We do not have it. We have models, economic, legal, and perhaps sociological models to cope with private goods and public goods, but not with common goods. Results. What do we observe? The destruction of the environment, the pollution, etc. Because just because the hair belongs to nobody in the to no entity, people feel authorized to destroy, to pollute, to cut the trees, and what we read every day, etc. And in spite of the fact that economic science exists since centuries, still we do not have any theory of commons. And that's the reason why the problem of the commons cannot be solved. Because any time the representatives of even of government sit around the table, other people say, but who authorizes you to decide for us? It's the whole community. But we do not still have a way to cope with it. Those of you who know, follow the literature, certainly will remember to the memory the name of Eleanor Ostrom. Eleanor Ostrom was a lady, American lady. She passed away 3 years ago, prematurely. And she was a political scientist. But she obtained the Nobel Prize in economics. That is the first time a woman obtained a Nobel Prize in economics, even though she was not an economist. She was a political. Why? Because her major contribution, Booker, has the following title, Governing the Commons. Governing the Commons. And in that book, she anticipated a certain lies, but then she passed away. The fault is the Nobel Prize. But that is true. Because she had a heart attack, because people were starting calling her here and there in all different parts of the world. She was not old, but with certain number of ages. Perhaps she had some heart problem before, and she passed away immediately. It's a pity, because she was very intuitive. And one of the major arguments was, we have to find communitarian ways of managing the commons, communitarian ways. In other words, governance structure. Now, if you pay attention, the last chapter of Caritas in Veritate by Pope Benedict XVI exactly addresses it. When he talks about polyarchy, when he says not the global government, as many people interpret the Pope saying, that's not. He was talking about global governance. And since you are English people, English trained people, you know the difference. Because in my language, Italian, we have only one word, governo. But governo means both government and governance. And most people mix up the two with difference. So this is the third major. We have too many private goods. We have many public goods, but we have too few common goods. And the result that we observe are evident. There is no need for me to show to you. So that is something which is typical of the present year. Because until 30, 40 years ago, such a problem did not exist. People were interested in having private goods. What is the typical example of private goods? This is a private good, because I drink it, and you can drink. Food was a private good. Public goods, such as roads, such as institutions, in a sense that was okay. But nowadays, our society, Western type society like yours, are in tremendous need of common goods, and we do not have enough of it. And that explains why our well-being is declining instead of increasing. I said well-being, not well-having. The well-having is increasing. Because we have become more and more rich. But our well-being to be is different from to have, as you understand. What is the fourth challenge, in part connected to what I just said, is the so-called happiness paradox. Now, the happiness paradox is something very serious. The happiness paradox was invented, or better to say, discovered by the American economist Richard Esther, who is still alive, when in 1974. Now, this piece of research, you cannot imagine, provoked an earthquake, in particular in the United States and then England and the rest of the world. Because being an empirical economist, statistician, he put here income per capita. Why is income? totally, and is the number of people. So that indicates income per capita. And you put on the vertical axis the index of happiness. Okay? And working with the American data, statistics, you obtained using statistical measures such as correlation analysis, etc., etc., what is nowadays called the estimate curve, which looks like this, more or less. What does it mean? It means that when my income, my in the sense of a group or individual, is low, my level of happiness is low. If my income increases, my level of happiness increases, but not forever, up to a point. When, in his days, 74, he indicated $22,000 per capita per year. So when the income reached this threshold, further increments of income per capita, instead of increasing, the happiness index increased. My goodness, that is a super paradox. You know, paradox is a Greek word. In Greek, paradox means surprise, something that you did not expect. Because we have been brought to believe that as a, if you become richer and richer, you will be more and more happy. But it is discovered that it's not true. Certainly, poor countries or poor communities are here in this area. They are not very happy because they do not have enough income to eat, to go to send to school children, to medicine if they are sick, etc. But our countries, and Malta is among them, we are in this area here. So, in our country, the level of index of happiness declines year after year, not because we lack income, but because our income per capita keeps on increasing. Per capita, which means does not take into consideration the distribution among people. But it is a fact that the total wealth is increasing year after year in our country, even though it is not distributed in a fair way, etc. Now, this is the so-called happiness part, which has a rigorous, is still rigorous and really make a revolution in social sciences and in particular economics. Because the argument is, what's the problem? What's the point of becoming more productive? What's the point of becoming more efficient to increase income? If at the end of the day, instead of being happier, we are less happy. Isn't it true, as Aristotle used to say, Aristotle, that human beings live for happiness? What is the purpose of our life? To be happy. Then people might interpret in different ways. But you will never find a human person saying, I do not want to be happy. I mean, everybody, St. Francis, when he decided to do what he did, leaving everything, poverty, etc. He said, I do that because I want to be happy. Not because, you see, I want to be gloomy, no. He was cheerful, not gloomy, etc. Of course, what does it mean? That we are confusing, that is the responsibility of the economist, the notion of happiness with the notion of utility. Utility is connected to income. Those of you who have studied economics know that the basic tenet of economics is to maximize utility. It is obvious that if my income grows up, I will buy three airplanes, or the Trump Tower. Trump. But it's not even sure if you could approach him, etc. In other words, utility, and that goes back to Aristotle, and St. Thomas was very clear on that. Utility is the property of the relation between the person and a thing. If I drink this water gives me utility. But if I say to you, drinking the water, I am happy, you have reason to believe that I got mad. Because it thinks never gives us utility. And sorry, happiness. It gives us utility. And utility is a good thing. What is happiness? It's the property of the relation between a human being and another human being. So that is why Aristotle said it is impossible to be happy alone. It needs to, it takes at least two people to be happy. Even better if there are many, but at least two people. Because unless, by the way, but I have no time to enter into these details, that is the reason why we, particularly in these days, the notion of the family, of the marriage, but now I do not want to enter into it because otherwise I will escape. And so that was the first misunderstanding, that the social sciences, and in particular Kant, made a culture making people believe that to be happy was coincident with maximizing beauty, which are two different things, two different. And nowadays people are opening their eyes because people want to be happy. I found myself many people saying, I'm not interested that much in utility, which means I'm content with a modest income, but I want to be happy. You understand what I mean? It's that I can accept poverty in the Franciscan sense, but not because I want to give up happiness. The opposite is true, etc. Nowadays, this area of research is one of the most developed in economics. Every 2 years, the United Nations published a report showing the happiness index of all the countries in the world. The last report was presented in Rome last March. The next one will be presented in New York every time they change the place. And go and check where it's going. You will see that it's declining year after year, or 2 years after 2 years. So we, in our society, and that explains, by the way, the youth problem. Our youngsters, they have a lot of things. They have all these technicalities, they have cars, they have motorbikes, they have everything. Good food, good drinks, but they are always unhappy. It's difficult today to find a young person who is cheerful. I remember I was belonged to a family very modest, like old and poor, but we were very happy. We took some, we didn't have the money to buy a ball to play. So we made a ball with some dust, but we enjoyed ourselves. Just to give you the sense. Today, our young people have everything, but if you talk to them, they say, oh, I'm not happy, etc. Now, I have no time to enter, but the relevant studies in this regard is the one coming from Daniel Kahneman. Kahneman is a psychologist, American psychologist, one of the top psychologists, and he obtained Kahneman's written evidence. Daniel Kahneman, and he obtained in 2004 the Nobel Prize in economics. In economics, in spite of the fact that he's a psychologist, why? Because he made an extension of the study started with health. So he applied in many different contexts, for instance, happiness between men and women. That is fascinating to see the difference between men and women. You take a woman and a man with the same level of income, with the same type of job, with the same, but they react differently in terms of happiness. And again, with young and old people, etc. And so Kahneman is an authority, and he deserved the Nobel Prize, and everybody knows his work. And they are very useful to know for those people who have educational responsibility. Because if we want to educate the young people today, we need to know a few things. Otherwise, we will never understand them. In other words, if we have to understand their situation in order to educate means to change their mood, etc. Otherwise, we run the risk of making only rhetoric or propaganda according to the case, etc. Now, that is a fourth challenge. How to cope with the happiness problem. Finally, a fifth, not finally because it's the last one, because time goes by, A fifth challenge has to do with the emergence of the so-called electoral democracy replacing liberal democracy. Now, I have to be clear, liberal does not mean neoliberalism. Liberal in the technical sense. Today, the democratic rule has been changed completely with respect to the past. You know, democracy is a Greek word. Aristotle was the first to write on the democratic principle, and he explained what does it mean to be democratic, etc. Now, if you pay attention, in the last few decades, the liberal democratic model has been replaced by the so-called electoral democratic model. In other words, today we identify democracy with the electoral rules. Every 4 years we go to vote, so we are voting, which is ridiculous. Only stupid people can believe that. Because democracy has nothing to do with the electoral rules. Nothing to do. The electoral rules are an instrument to achieve democracy, not vice versa. You cannot change or exchange the means with the ends. The fact that is, why is that so? The reason is because today the economic sphere is dominating the political sphere. That is the problem. In other words, until the emergence of globalization, it was the political authority which indicated to the economic authorities what were the targets, what the Greek called telos. Telos in Greek means the final end. And the economic forces operated in order to achieve in the most possible ways that target. Today is the opposite. Today it is the politicians who are serving the economic targets. I'm sure that you know examples really proving that. Let me only mention one. In November 1999, Clinton, President of the United States, abolished the Glass-Steagall Law. Glass-Steagall Law was approved in 1933 by Roosevelt. Well, Roosevelt, after the crisis, 29th crisis. That law established that banks should keep separate the money for doing a commercial activity from the money for doing speculation. So you are a bank. If you want to speculate, okay, but you have to speculate with your money, not with the money of the depositors. That was the Glass-Steagall Law. Now, the seventh system, which means that the seven top banks, Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, etc., went to see Clinton and said, "Dear Clinton, you are big. You have to make us a small favor. You have to abolish, abrogate." And he did. Why? Because he was threatened. Because he had to do that. Because they were blackmailing him, saying, unless you are abolished, we will transfer all our, let's say, activities elsewhere in Malta. So you will become very rich. And so you already had to. 6 years after, 2007, we had the crisis. Why people do not ask themselves this question? From 1933 to 2007, in the United States, there was no financial crisis. How many years? 70, more than 70 years. Now, 6 years after the abolition or abrogation of the Glass-Steagall Law, the crisis. Now, this is only one example to show that the political leaders, they believe to be the king makers, not that person. The king makers are the economic. Why is it so? Because we moved from a competitive model of capitalism to an oligopolistic model of capitalism. You know what is oligopoly or monopoly, monopolization or... Let me give you two data. Today, 800 firms in the world, 800, generate 50% of the global GDP. Can you imagine? 800 in the world, there are perhaps 20, 25 million of firms. 800 firms generates half the total GDP. And you understand the implication. They have a power of blackmailing any authority, even the United States, in a way that in the past never existed. Another example, let me see whether I have the exact figure or not. Yes, here. The top 10 banks share of the market deposit moved from 20% to 50% from 1980 to today. In other words, you know the market deposit, the banks, they collect money from the deposit. Now, the top 10 banks in the world today control more than 50% of the whole total deposit. Now, in 1980, that share was only 20%. So that means that when the globalization and third and fourth industrial revolution started, the process of concentration of power, that is the word, concentration of power. And then they generate, but you are not interested in that, from for a theoretical point of view, major question to economic science. Because economic science was always under the assumption that more or less markets were competitive. Nowadays, that is why what is neoliberalism? That is why neoliberalism is different from liberalism. Liberalism was the idea according to which you believe in free competition and free enterprise. But every enterprise has to respect the rules of the game. Neoliberalism is the, let's say, degeneration of that, because you have a concentration of power. And economic power, as history teaches us, always determines political power and what? Cultural power. Cultural power. Because the dominating forces are not happy to say, well, we are happy to maintain our power. They want to change the frame, the mindset, the frame of mind of the people, that through culture. Typically, I'm sure that you read in a few years ago the book about Coca-Colonization of the world. Coca-Cola, which is disgusting, at least for me as a drink. But why people? Because there are much better drinks. No, that is admitted by everybody. Why? Because people associate that drink to a particular model of consumption. The idea is if you drink Coca-Cola, you are like Americans. And so everybody has to drink Coca-Cola. Not because of the quality, the intrinsic quality, because people should ask, why nobody drank Coca-Cola before? Because Coca-Cola started after the Second World War. In our countries, it arrived only in the late 70s. That is a fact. If it were a good thing to drink, people should have drunk before. But it was a model of framing the mind, in particular the young stuff, etc., etc. So now, this poses this fifth challenge, a real problem, that we are running a risk of losing real democracy in favor of electoral democracy. That is why we keep on talking about electoral rules, in order to circumvent and manipulate the mind of people. But look, even in Soviet Union, there were elections. You know that. Even in China, today they have elections every 4 years. But can you say that those are democratic? Of course not. So if you identify democracy with the election, you do not get the point. You know the definition that Aristotle gave of the democratic principle, etc. That's why we today keep on talking about deliberative democracy as the frontier of the democratic principle to be implemented in our society, etc. So now, at this point, I could continue, but these are enough, these five challenges. The question then is, why that occurred? In other words, what are the major factors determining the emergence of these challenges? I indicate, for reasons of time, The first one is the implicit acceptance of the principle of Noah. Never heard about Noah. That is even philosophers never mentioned Noah. And that's important. Noah is an English acronym which says non-overlapping magisteria. Non-overlapping magisteria, Noah. Now, the principle of Noah was for the first time introduced by Richard Watley. Now, Richard Watley, he was professor, chair professor of economics in the University of Oxford. And he became very influential in England. I'm sure that English trained people should know, because he became bishop of the Anglican Church. And in England, if you are the head of the Anglican Church, you sit in the Lords, and you are an important figure. So if you are chair professor, in 1829, during the opening of the new academic year at the University of Oxford, Richard Watley pronounced a memorable speech, in the course of which he introduced the principle of Noma. The principle of Noma, he said the following: in our societies, there are three spheres. That is the sphere of ethics. That is the sphere of politics, and that is the sphere of economics. Each one has its own. The ethic sphere is the sphere with the reign of values, where what is good, what is bad should be decided. The political sphere is the reign or the kingdom of ends, the ends that society wants to pursue. Finally, the economic sphere is the kingdom of means. In this sphere, people are supposed to provide means. And he said, if economics wants to maintain its status, in the epistemological sense of a science, should then cut the relations with the other spheres. That is the reason why, even nowadays, most economists all over the world believe that economics is a neutral science. Yes. Because the argument Watley is rather deep. He said, if I am an economist, I am concerned only with the means to look for the optimal means to achieve the ends, and the ends should be controlled by the ethical rules. Why should I bother as an economist with ethics and politics? So economics has nothing to do with the ethical reason. Economics has its own laws. The market laws, demand, supply, blah, 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 etc. So why should we bother? Because if I am a servant, looking after means is to be a servant. See, if you are a servant, would you bother about the ends of your master? Of course not. You would say, my master tells me that I have to do this, I will do. And so what happened is that look at the dates, 160 years, economics as a social science was developed, that economists are only concerned to find the optimal ways to achieve that. As such, they are not to be considered responsible of the consequences. Because the responsibility lies in this two spheres. If something goes wrong in economics, the fault is of the politician or of the ethicist, of those dealing with that, because they have no clear idea. They do not dictate the proper distinction between what is admissible or not admissible. It's not the fault. That is the reason why economics became what is today, what I said before. Because economists felt themselves irresponsible from a moral and political point. They were only responsible of achieving the best ways, the best method in order to maximize income, to maximize utility, etc., etc. And so that is the major cause of the five challenges I was talking about. And that is very, very important. And in fact, go and control, take any textbook. No, there are few exceptions. I have written many textbooks in economics. I never accepted that even a long time ago. I was trained in Oxford, and I always objected to my teach to my supervisor. Because they said, oh, don't worry, because if something goes wrong in the economic sphere, you can be sure that the politician or those in charge of the political sphere will take action. At the beginning, it was like that. But when globalization started, and the fourth industrial revolution started, because nowadays our politicians cannot control the economy. That is the trick of the game. Because the Prime Minister of Malta can control economic affairs in Malta. But if a Maltese firm has relations with abroad, the Malta government cannot impose its own rules to another country. That is obvious. You know, if you read the newspaper, you remember the case of Apple. Of Fiat. Fiat is an Italian car factory. Fiat is no longer Italian. They moved the headquarters from Turin, you know Turin, to Amsterdam. Why? Because the Amsterdam legal system is much more fair in terms of charging taxes than the Italian system. And so a firm which is identified with Italy is no longer Italian. So can the Italian government say to Fiat, now you have to pay tax? No, he says, I'm not Italian. My headquarters is based in Amsterdam. Not to mention the so-called paradisi fiscali, fiscal heavens. Why people will keep on maintaining fiscal heavens? For the same reason. So now, this is the point, which is important. Because Richard Watley, of course, he couldn't imagine. Perhaps it wasn't bona fide, it was very intense. But that is important. When a mistake is done on the cultural front, many disasters, sooner or later, always happen. Because this is a culture. Because perhaps, as I said, it wasn't bona fide by saying that I want to increase the importance of economics. Because in those days, economics as a science was not particularly important, as you can imagine. Well, existed, but they were still the time of the first industrial revolution, which ended up in 1840 in England, 1840, the end of the first industrial revolution. So that is the first reason why that the new problems I was talking about occurred. The second, oh, by the way, to conclude, that Nova principle provoked what is called nowadays moral disengagement. If you want to deepen, read the last book by Bandura. Bandura is an American psychologist, which is the number one in the world in his field. And his last book has the title Moral Disengagement. It's a fascinating book, fascinating. Joseph Bandura. He says, what is a moral disengagement? It's a cognitive process whereby people acknowledge certain ethical principles, but they deactivate at the personal level in order to justify their own misbehavior. Talk to certain bankers, not the people who work in a bank, but the top bankers. They say, oh, I believe in morality, they will repeat like you might teach them. But you ask yourself, why then in your personal life do you do not follow those principles? Because of moral disengagement, which is a cognitive process whereby I try to justify myself. The gospel from this point of view, the first one who was opening our eyes to that was Jesus. Well, you remember the pages of the gospel. So. But it is important that today people like Bandura, he's a rather is almost 86, 87, so he's a mature person, and many other people, are, from an experimental point of view, proved that this occurred. Because they made a sort of interviews in different fields, etc. In other words, it's not like in the past people said, I do not believe to your principles. And that is particularly important today. I come in a minute for Christianity. Nobody today is against Christianity. Oh, everybody would say, oh, we like Christian principles. Like, it's not like in the past when we had atheists. The atheists said, no, we remember what Marx said about the church. No, no, today it's not polite to politically correct, as we say, to combat Christianity. But they will never practice what Christianity. Why is that so? Moral disengagement. And that is, if you read the book, it's fascinating because Bandura describes, in a psychologist, clinical psychologist, what is the, how, in practice, we human beings behave. It's like those who started taking a small vice. Take a pinch of drug. And they're exactly the same. And they say, oh, I will take one only for, I want to test. And they will never get rid. Because after they've taken it, their mind operates in such a way as to justify their behavior. Because they would say, that's not a major problem, etc. So let's try a second time. And that is the difference. Now, in economics today, moral disengagement is the major issue for business leaders. More business leaders. The second cause of what we are describing has to do with the moral, let's say, cultural phenomenon, which, to synthesize, I will explain as follows. As you know, Christianity is at the root of the emergence of a market economy. Because the market economy is a creation of Christian culture, you know that, starting in 14th, 15th century in Italy, because the market economy was born in Tuscany, Florence, etc., and then developed in different parts of the world. Then there was the Reform, Lutheran Reform, Calvin, etc. And so, what happens today is the following, that in our part of the world, Christianity is blamed for having given birth to capitalism. On the other hand, in the Eastern world, Asia, China or India, the opposite is true. In other words, they praise Christianity for having given birth to the market economy, because now they are applying the market economy. I mean, China is a truly market economy, as you say, it's in itself. But yet they want to get rid of Christianity, because they say Christianity has done its job until recently. Now there is no longer any need of Christianity. That is the notion of indifference. It's indifferent. So if you want to be Christian, go ahead. I do not care. I do not, let's say, fight against you. But you should know that you are irrelevant, because what you, as a cultural model, have that has already been done. We have created the market economy. And the market economy is the most advanced form of economic organization in a society. So now, the situation of Christianity is ironic. In our world, Western world, Christianity is blamed because it has generated a capitalistic model which went outside its, let's say, track and became neoliberal. The challenges I was talking about. In the Eastern world, they praised it. Look what happened with China these days. Oh, they said, my goodness, Matteo Ricci, you know, the first Jesuit with great consideration, etc. But stop. So we remember Christianity as a memento de history. But Christianity has never to teach us in this days. Because that explains the fenomenal reservoir, as the French say, vis-a-vis Christianity, as a religion. Not so much as a faith, but as a religion. You know, there is a difference between religion and faith. Now, this poses a problem. This problem, in my interpretation, is the one which helps us understanding the strategy of Pope Francis. Namely, Pope Francis, much better than his predecessor, but not because his predecessor did not, because the time has not yet come, has understood that the real struggle today is between two religions. Global capitalism as a religion and Christianity as a religion, with the difference that Christianity is a transcendental religion. Global capitalism is a immanentistic religion. Now, you are sure that you know the book published in 1920 by Walter Benjamin. Walter Benjamin, philosopher, very important. The point is this regard. Now, in 1920, he published a book whose title was Capitalism as Religion. That is the title. He understood everything. But the point is that in 1920, the time was not yet ripe to understand. That is why most people said he must be mad, he must be stupid. And they stopped. And in fact, it was never republished. It's only a few years ago that that book has been republished. Because if you read, what is happening today. In other words, today global capitalism, you have to say global, global means globalized, has become a new religion, which is immanentistic. And in fact, it has its liturgy, it has its priest. The priests are the big bankers, are the big entrepreneurs, the eight men in the world who has as much wealth as 50% of the total world population, eight people. One is Bill Gates, another one is the other one, Zuckerberg, etc. Eight. They calculated that their wealth is the same as the wealth of 3.5 billion people. Not bad, eh? So these are the new priests. And when they speak, listen, they say stupid things, never mind. Oh, it has been said by Bill Gates. Is it true or not? And the young people, I live with the young people, because I teach in university, so from 1925, and I keep on talking with the young people. They say, that is the new Moses. Moses. They are the new Moses. No, I'm not joking. Because it is enough that, for instance, 3 days ago, no, 4 days ago, Bill Gates, in an interview, said, we have to tax the robots. You know, what are the robots? The intelligent robots. Because since they produce income, they do not pay taxes. So we have to find a way to pay. And now everybody, prime ministers, we have to think about that in an interview which I gave to tell them in the newspaper, like asking me, they said, that is the sign of stupidity. Because is it possible that if Bill Gates, who is intelligent, is good, but he's not a genius, he says something everybody should bow in front of him, say, oh, we have to take into consideration. So now, you understand why, what is the strategy of the present Pope? That explains why the Pope Francis speaks in the way he speaks. Sometimes in an aggressive way, sometimes in a mood which is typical of Latin America. That is why you will never understand him properly, because you have all the English culture. But we Italian, we understand it better, because there are certain similarities. But sometimes he's not aggressive, but he speaks out of the mouth, as you say. And most people do not tolerate. They say, oh, it's not nice, it's not. But he's interested in raising the issue that today the great attack against Christianity is exactly the emergence of a new religion, immanentistic religion, which is global capitalism, whose target is growth, to maximize income, what I said before. And in order to maximize income, you have to behave in a particular way. But in order to maximize income, firms have to sell what they produce. But how do they do that? Inducing people to buy what they have produced. Because unless you buy this thing, this is as old as my grandmother, but I keep this as a son. But now the new instruments, the young people have to buy that every 6-7 months because they keep on changing. And why is that so? Is the phenomenon is consumption induction, it's called technically. The propaganda, the marketing induce people to consume things which would never be otherwise consumed. And that is necessary because homo consumans is replacing homo laborers. Before, homo laborers in Latin means the man who works, the worker. Today, the key figure is no longer the worker, it's the consumer. Because the big firms, the big consumers to buy more than they have decided to produce. So now, this is the reason why we are facing today this challenge, which ultimately, in particular for the Christians, is the major one. In other words, the problem is how to cope with that. With the first cause, the nomad, things are changing. I can assure you. Being an economist myself, I can assure that not the majority, but an important minority of economists all over the world are getting rid of nomads. I can assure you. It is difficult to find people believing in homo economicus. If a professor, there are some professors, because stupid people always remain for a long time, but in general, nobody speaks this language nowadays. So, we have to reach still a certain level, but that is in a sense, where we are lagging behind is on the second front, that people are not realizing that global capitalism is a new religion. And they behave like believers in a proper religion. And that is, for Christians in particular, a real fight. Because you have a religion against another religion. Before, the fight was between Christianity and atheism, communism, you know. But that was easy. And that battle was won by the Christian. You remember John Paul II? He was Polish, and he did a lot to the fight against the Soviet communism, and he won. Because it was like a battle where you had one against another. Today, the battle is more subtle because global capitalism is an immanentistic religion which operates through the moral sentiments of people. You want to be happy, maximize utility. You want, etc., etc. At this point, I have to stop because I have to admit that we do not have yet a strategy. The present Pope is trying to do that. That is why he is criticized by conservatives. The point is that the conservative, not in the political sense, but in those who maintain, have not, they lack intelligence. Because if when I explain to them what I'm trying to do this morning to you, they change. And they tell me, we never thought of that. Because the conservative believes that the important thing is to fight against the non-believers. No, because that is easy. The fight is between other believers in the wrong religion. You remember the golden calves. We are coming back to the golden calf when Moses, you remember the story. And they were creating a calf, golden, beautiful, and people today, mutatis mutandis, is the same situation. And so That is why initiatives like yours are important. I would like to conclude with a passage which is from Tocqueville. You know Tocqueville. Tocqueville is an influential figure. Alexis Tocqueville French, he published in 1835 his important book. Title is Democracy in America. It's a fundamental book. It's one of the most 10 most important books in our Western civilization. He was the son of his father. What does it mean? His father did the French Revolution. And after the French Revolution, Robespierre put the guillotine. The son, Alexis, who was 21, he had a crisis. He said, well, what's that? My father fought for the liberté, égalité, fraternité, and as a sign of gratitude, they cut that. And he, at that point, he converted himself to Catholicism. He became Catholic before he was atheist. And then he went to the United States. He said, I want to know, how is that society? Whether or not it functions like the French society. And when he got back to Paris, he published this book in 1835, Democracy in America. Look, listen to this passage. Despotism sees in the separation among men the guarantee of its continuance. And it usually makes every effort to keep them separate. A despot easily forgives his subject for not loving him, provided that they do not love one another. That's beautiful, my friend. Because it means that if we want to get rid of the new forms of despotism today, and there are many forms of despotism, what is the recipe, the physician recipe, to going back to love each other? Because if we love, you know, loving with sense, the sense of charity, then that is the best sign that the other one is a false religion. And so there is what I envisage, the possibility of winning even this fundamental part. And I conclude with another poet famous from India, Tagore. Tagore obtained the Nobel Prize in literature almost a century ago. In one of his poems, he concludes by saying, when the sun declines, don't cry, because the tears will not allow you to admire the stars. That is important. We live in a period when the sun is declining, this period. But we should not cry, because otherwise we will be unable to admire the stars. And if we pay attention, even in the present days, there are many stars to be admired, provided that we do not cry and we do not become desperate. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have a short break for about 15 minutes, so that also you can take a coffee or something. And then we get together again, so that we'll start a bit of discussion. But we have to finish at 11, so...
We can finish at 11:10. 10 past 11. Because you drive very well. Yes, you accompany me to the house. Because you go to Bologna.
How has globalization impacted the capital markets, especially in the equity markets?
Thank you. Let me collect some of the questions. Three at the father market. Father.
I wanted to make two questions. We seem to separate very powerfully the politician from the economist. Whereas most politicians today are economists, and the economists or politicians, and it seems that the model is to have a politician who is an economist and can manage the country. That's one thing. Secondly, I don't think I understood whether you find one single good thing about neoliberalism. I don't think I understood that you mentioned one single advantage. For instance, or were they neoliberalism and Christianity agree on anything? For instance, one of the things that I think they agree on is that they remove boundaries and remove frontiers. Both of them agree on that. That there shouldn't be boundaries that separate the human race. I think both of them agree on that.
Thank you.
You said that liberal democracy, electoral democracy is replaced with liberal democracy. It's not democracy of the people, for the people, and by the people. Electoral democracy linked to electoral democracy.
Thank you. So
I
ask now, please, the first term, and then we move to the second term. Thank you very much. Let me start from this last one in reverse. As you know, as we know, right from the time of Aristotle, the democratic principle is based on two pillars. The first pillar says that those who are in power and who are decision makers should be made accountable to the people. Accountable, not only transparent. Because transparency is one thing, accountability is something different. The second pillar says that those who have to accept the rule imposed by the ruler should have always the right to have two options, voice and exit. Voice means civilized protest, exit means having the possibility of leaving the polity in case of extreme disagreement. Now, these are the two pillars. And in fact, in these pillars, votation, elections are not part. Because election is a mean, is an instrument in order to implement the two pillars, etc. Now, look what happens today. Our politicians, they are not accountable. At the most, they are transparent, because that is important. But technically speaking, the movement is from rule of law to the rule by law. You see the difference. The rule of law, for instance, in countries like China, India, etc., there is no rule of law, there is the rule by law. And that is a completely different. By the way, the rule of law was introduced in England already at the time of Magna Carta. Magna Carta 1215. That was a major effect. So, but in most countries, the rule of law is not applied at all, even though they utilize the electoral method in order to select, so to speak, the ruler, etc. So what we have to consider is that to go back to the foundations of the democratic principle. That is why the notion of the liberty democracy, which today is spread in all our Western countries, is gaining ground. That means that people have to have access to the process of decision making, not only at the moment they cast a vote, but also in the time between one election and another. And in fact, we are bit by bit moving in our country, Western countries, with differences. For instance, the French have utilized the method, they are different from the Germans, etc. But it is obvious that the ruler do not accept that. Because if I'm a politician, I said, vote for me, and I promise that I will do that, that, that. But as you know, Max Weber was the first to write that politicians, once they have been elected, they are not compelled to maintain their promises. I agree myself. Because they said the promises belong to what is called political marketing. Well, if I am a producer of this water, I write here, drink this water, this is the most important, beautiful, good water in the world, etc. But that does not correspond to reality. But still, that is allowed. It's allowed because in order to sell my product, it's the same as the world. So that is why we have to reinvent the application of the rule of law, not by law. Second, we need to avoid neo-patrimonial states, because there are elites today who operate in such a way as to interfere with the process of lawmaking. You know that most of our rules in our countries are not dictated by parliamentary members, but by lobbyists who are pressured. Now, the other question, what do you say? He said, why I didn't mention the good things of neoliberalism? Because I took them for granted. But you are right, there are good things. First of all, the decline in poverty. You know, people tend to confuse poverty with inequalities, but that is different issue. Poverty in the last 40 years has declined enormously. Today, absolute poor in the world are a bit less than 800 million. Without globalization, they would have been 2 billion. So one could say that in 40 years, globalization or neoliberalism has subtracted from, let's say, the extreme poverty situation, 1,200,000,000 people. And that is a good thing. But what is the point? That at the same time, neoliberalism has increased its inequalities. The point is that unless you keep the distinction between these two concepts, you will never make a dialogue. I admit that neoliberalism has increased poverty, and that's good. But at the same time, the price that we have to pay in order to diminish poverty is the tremendous increase. Read the last book by Branko Milanovic. Branko Milanovic is the chief economist of the World Bank. And Branko Milanovic, the book I'm talking about, Milanovic, his biology from Serbia, it's American. And the title of the book, which was published 6 months ago, is called The Global Inequality. That is a fascinating, not technical, everybody can understand it. And that is important. General economists tend to write the equation, you know, confused idea, but yes, everybody can understand. And what we discover, it is a result that nobody can explain. Global inequality proved empirically that in the last 40 years, neoliberalism has increased inequalities in an amount equal to the previous generation. In particular, he became famous in the last few months because he created the so-called elephant curve. You have an elephant curve. And you put here the curve which looks like this, like an elephant, which is, and that is, you say, the track, no? Now, what does it mean? It means the following, that here you have the percentiles of representing the income level. The poor have increased their own. And the rich, the top 1% of the population, have become tremendously richer. That is the reason of the drug being almost perfect. On the other hand, the so-called middle classes, have declined very much. That is the so-called elephant curve, everybody today. Why that is important? Because democracy is supported by middle classes. try to think. Because the poor, they are not interested in democracy. If you are poor, the sense that you are, you know, by the way, who is poor. Some of you has less than $1.9 per day. If your income is less than $2 per day, you are considered absolutely poor, which means starving. If you are poor, you are not interested in democratic rule. You are interested in food. On the other hand, the rich, very rich people, are not interested in democracy. They are interested in oligarchy, aristocracy, but not democracy. That is what is written in Aristotle. The point is that people do not study, and they do not know things. So it's an oligarchy. And Sir Thomas wrote the same. Is the middle classes the real supporter of the democratic race? So what Milano is concludes in his book, we run the risk of what I said before, of losing democracy, because our middle classes, having deteriorated their position in the last 40 years, of course in different degrees, in different countries, that explains the emergence of populism. You know what is populism? Or neo-populism. France, England, Nigeria, France, you know, Marine Le Pen in France, etc. Trump in the United States. How is it possible that a man like Trump, one of the richest, has been voted by the middle classes? That is an expression. Because if you belong to a middle class and you observe that your position is declining, then out of desperation or as a sort of vengeance, you say, well, don't you vote for something? So that is the point. But it is true that poverty has declined because the poor, because here you are in per capita, both poor have increased and the other. The other point, important point, is what you said, is the barriers. Yes. And that is again, but at the same time, because the problem of neoliberalism is exactly that it's ambiguity. In general, something positive, at the same time, something negative. For instance, in this regard, the destruction of barriers is itself good. But what about migration? At the very moment you destroy the barriers, you provide no means to cope with the migrant flow. Because it is obvious that if you destroy barriers, people living in Africa or Latin America, they move. But at that very moment you say, we do not want them. So that is a sort of what we call pragmatic, in philosophy, pragmatic contradiction. Because you do something in one direction without taking into consideration the third. It is obvious that neoliberalism has increased tremendously income. And that is good in itself, because increasing wealth is not something bad, something good, not to mention the innovation. Those connected to the so-called industry 4.0. New technologies, these are something good. But again, you can use those technologies for the good or for the bad. And so we are good. But in conclusion, it is true that this not everything is negative. And that is obvious, because if it were everything was negative, it wouldn't resist. Neoliberalism, this is why it's a new religion. Because it has produced important good things. Yes, that is why most people are following and believing that it will settle or solve the problems of the country, which, as we are observing, is not true. Now, the question of the capital markets. Now, to answer, as you know, in moral philosophy, or even moral theory, when we talk about moral responsibility, there are three types of moral responsibility. Direct, indirect, and adiaphoric. The point is that is the fault, not what we call it, of philosophers, ethicists. They always talk about direct and indirect responsibility, but never, almost never, of adiaphoric. Adiaphoric is a Greek word, which means a technical responsibility, I explained. Now, what is a direct responsibility? Everyone understands. If with my car I kill you, I am directly responsible for your death. No. If your wife, because of your death, dies because of say heart attack, I am indirectly responsible of her death. Okay? Everybody understands. But why nobody talks about adiaphoric responsibility? You know who was the first to talk about that in a different context? Paul VI. Paul VI was very good. His encyclical Populorum Progressio, this year we celebrate the 50th anniversary, he was the first to introduce in Catholic social teaching the notion of structures of sin. Now, structure of sins is nothing but a nickname of adiaphoric responsibility. He said, in our society, which means in 67, there are structures of sin. In other words, structures such as institutions, market, capital market, for instance, which induce good people to generate bad results. That is why I'm called structures of sin. And in other words, we have to get accustomed that when we design a new set of rules of economic or financial games, it's not enough to pay attention to the direct responsibility or the indirect responsibility. We have also to consider what will be the final results of the implementation of those rules once they've been enacted. That is the case of adiaphoric responsibility. And we never pay attention. In other words, even institutions are responsible, not only human beings. Because there are certain elements which are embodied in institutions. You want an example? Concrete? Here. The Commodity Stock Exchange of Chicago, not the other one in Wall Street, is the largest in the world. Until the year 2010, they allowed the emission of derivatives, the bankers, who are banking on, having as a collateral the price of fundamental commodities such as rice, such as mice, etc. Okay? In other words, you were allowed to, you are a bank, to allocate these derivatives having as their fundamental the price of this. The speculative mechanism in the time span of few months produced a doubling of the prices of these commodities. What was the result? That in Africa and in Southeastern Asia, people relatively poor, whose diet was based on rice, etc., they died. Died of that. So the question is, who is responsible for that? Tell me, who is responsible? Because those of who dictated the rule, they said, we were not thinking of that. We didn't want to generate something back to those people. We never met them. They were far away. What was the answer? In fact, Obama passed a law in the year, at the end of 2010 saying, from now onwards, it is abolished to denominate a derivative on the prices of fundamental commodities. Because the argument was exactly what I said before. It is true that you did not want to generate the death of those people. But you have created a structure or an institution. Institution means the rules of the game, of the financial game, in such a way as people who were not part of that game suffered the consequences. And that is, from a moral point of view, cannot be tolerated. But nobody talks about this. For economists, those are called pecuniary externalities. Pecuniary externalities. There is a Dominican father who is in America, who three years ago published a important book with Cambridge University Press exactly on this issue. It's fascinating. And then it's interesting because he has not been for, and he's Dominican. Why don't you read that? And it is based on the scripture, the sacred scripture itself. He's also an economist. He also teaches economics at the University Providence. And because he said, sometimes we never pay attention to institutions. He said, institutions are legal, but the fact that something is legal does not mean that it is legitimate. One thing is legality, another thing is legitimacy. Because a law is legitimate if it is compatible with the ethical requirements. But we never think about it. And that is why capital markets started this behavior. Because the only responsibility was the personal responsibility of the CEO of the prospect, which is okay, but that is not enough. Please.
There was a theologian, methodologist, philosopher, and economist who was a Jesuit, Father Bernard Lonergan.
Yes.
Now, I'd like to hear what you think of his circulation analysis theory in economics, and also what you think of his idea of cosmopolis.
Thank you.
Somebody else?
Thank you for your presentation, which is basically, I interpreted it as bringing down to simple understanding a lot of complex concepts. One of them is your closing comment about hope. Basically, I interpret your closing comment about the sun going down, and don't cry out in order to be able to see the stars. I think one of the stars is ethics. And the separation of ethics from economics and from politics is very evident, obviously, with progress. And I think one of the stars, really, that we ought to see when the sun goes down is ethics and the solution of dianetics. And I think people are seeing ethics as a very intangible concept. And we can give us some ideas on how to bring it down to earth for people to believe in ethics. We're born with ethics, but we lose it as we grow, and as we become richer, and as we become more affluent. We need to bring it back down, if you can help us a bit with how we can do that.
Thank you. So please, time for the last one. Third, please.
I was wondering whether there is a link between what we have been talking about and the fact that ideas in society seem to become even more polarized than ever. So someone who has, maybe like in America, someone who is in favor of Trump, they are so strong in their beliefs that they fail to see the ideas of the other people on the other side, and vice versa. So I was wondering if you see a link between what you have been talking about and this fact.
Thank you. So thank you very much. Okay, I know the word of it. Sorry?
Round about 5 minutes.
Yes, it's <He's> German, right? I know Lonergan. It's very much. The point is that the work of Lonergan is based on a pre-globalization year. If he were alive today and be able to write, I'm sure that he would update certain of his points. But his approach is very important. Cosmopolis is one of them. The point, as I said, nowadays it's a bit obsolete for the reason not because the cost doesn't matter. Because the reality has changed. I mean, in these days, the fourth industrial revolution did not exist yet. And then, being a proper scientist, he was reflecting the rest of the new things of his time, which is different. But you are right, he
concept in played an important role.
Now, as you're right, ethic has been proclaimed irrelevant. Irrelevant because the norma separating the three spheres, perhaps Waterley did not realize the implication that if you maintain the ethic spheres within itself, ethics at the end of the day will become irrelevant. Nowadays we observe a change. That was the question. For instance, why do we talk today about business ethics? Until 30 years ago, did not exist in such question. Did not. Look, read Milton Friedman. He would say that business ethics is a nonsense. But today, in all major universities, Malta included, there are courses in business ethics. And the idea of business ethics, I know that not everything is accepted, but I'm saying, at least in the Western world, feel the necessity of talking business ethics is a sign of indicating the overcoming of the democracy. And in my opinion, that is a positive thing. Now, another example has to do with corporate social responsibility. Why today we talk about corporate social responsibility? As you know, the notion was invented, coined in 1954 in the United States by an American economist, not particularly known, whose name was Bowen, Richard Bowen. But nowadays, everybody accepts it. And Milton Friedman said, corporate social responsibility, you must be mad. Because the only responsibility of a firm is to maximize profit. Nowadays, nobody says like that. As you know, in the United States, 7 years ago, 2010, a law was passed in the United States introducing a new figure, which is called the COPS. Because means benefit corporation. Go and read. What is a benefit corporation? It's a corporation which is no longer capitalistic. And the fact that the Americans have created them, and nowadays in Italy we have a similar law, France is doing a similar law soon, etc., it's an indication of what it is. So there are signs of novelty which make a new hope is available to our life. And finally, what you said is correct. The point is that economic dominance always implies cultural dominance. To change the frame of mind or the cognitive maps of people. Of course, what we have to consider is that so far, for reasons of time, I talked about ethics, but it is proper always to remind that the three are the major ethical matrices. One is the ethics of virtue. Ethical virtue goes back to Aristotle and to St. Thomas. The second one is utilitarian ethics, going back to Bentham, Jeremy Bentham, 1789. And the third one is the deontological ethics, going back to Kant. Kant is the one who said, fiat justitia pereat munus. Deontologism is the ethical rules. Utilitarianism is the ethics of consequences. And the third one is the ethical virtue. Of course, social doctrine of the church is based upon the ethical virtue. What is lacking here? But those who know me know that I always make this distinction when they ask me. Because a lot of confusion is generated when you talk generically about ethics. You have to specify which ethic. And even in public debates, to my those who discuss with me, I always ask them, please, in front of everybody, tell us which cultural ethics, cultural metrics, are you adhering to? Because people are sometimes, want to chisel around to make people believe, because ethics is a nice word. No, you have to specify. Because the ethical virtue, as you know, brings us completely different results than the utilitarian ethics. For utilitarian ethics, consequentialism is the one. You have to pay attention only to the consequences. If you ask Kant, Kant will say you have to pay attention to the intention. The intention The ethical virtue says that it's ethical what is the result of a process of education with the practice of virtue. And the virtues are seven, like the seven capital vices. That is important. Seven and seven. And you know what Thomas said. The most important virtue is prudence. Auriga virtutum, Latin. Because prudence, phronesis in Greek, is the virtue which pulls all other virtues. And so today we need, especially in education system, those having educational responsibility, because prudence is misinterpreted. Prudence is the virtue helping us to understand the ultimate consequences of a certain action. That is why before I talked about other forms. In fact, prudence comes from Latin providentia. Providentia means in Latin to be able to see far, very far in the future. And so, perhaps that is already, I observe there is a new interest, in particular in the Anglo-Saxon world, Anglo-Saxon university to work at this time. And that is for me, at least for me. I am optimistic by nature. And so I'm never, this glass is always for me half full, never half empty. But I think I have reason to believe that there are some. Think, for instance, ethical finances. Ethical finances, you know, 20% of all the financial transactions in the world today are ethical finances. Today we talk of social impact bonds, social impact finance. These are novelties. We talk about fair trade. We talk about voting by wallet, not voting by wallet, that were invented by English people. Voting by quality, it's a movement in different countries of the world which is spreading enormously and it has a major impact and so on and so forth. So that is why before I said that we have to follow Tagore here, because there is no need to run, because signs of changes are already in place. What we have to do is to accelerate, that is true. But because the present model is unsustainable from a social point of view. See, we have already something intelligent people. That is the point of concern. They believe that it is enough to do few reforms. Pope Francis, in a memorable speech, said, I am not a reformist, I am a transformation. He believes in transformations, not in reform. Because in the reform, you maintain the institutional setup as it was before. You just attach, how do you say, una pezza, riches. What we have to do is to transform pieces of our, for instance, the financial system, the fiscal system, because the fiscal system has to be transformed. And that is perhaps the strategy which opens, in particular with the young generation, a new hope in the future which is possible. And never forget that only dead things go with the current. Living things or living people can go against the current and the stream. Now, he has to compel me to leave you. So I apologize because I have enjoyed talking with you. I already talked to most of you, asking what you are doing, etc. I wish you really all the best and try to be always enjoyed. Because if you take joy, almost 40-50% of the problem can be solved. Because genre divertis in Italian. You know what is divertis?
Yes.
Comes from Latin, divertere. And divertere in Latin means to go out of oneself in order to meet the face of another. That was the original meaning of divertis. So try to divertis in this sense. Thank you very much.
Zamagni, thank you for your participation. Surely it was very interesting and very stimulating. I hope that our reflection will not stop here, but we have to continue also on our personal reflections, but also church, so that we really can build not just awareness but also action. Thank you very much.
I left some material with him, so yes, if you want, you can duplicate.